Tape is away, hold on. Tape is rolling and action.
Do I need to do the chord again?
Should I do it again?
To the basement, that's BASSmint. Like to welcome our viewers, the Detroit bass players around the world. Welcome to the basement, and we have with us, tell us your name, sir.
My name is Kevin Chown.
The Kevin Chown.
The one and only.
That's yes, the Kevin Chown.
As far as I know.
Indeed.
Might be
more. Bass player extraordinaire.
Now, folks, we're going to do an interview with him, but first we got to acknowledge our other panel.
Please.
And
I'm honored to be amongst the royalty of Detroit bass playing.
All right, so we're going to start over this way. We got with us an orange.
Oh, right. Pope Star, Pope Metropolis, Pope Fiction, all them popes, right there.
Right, a Detroit bass player alumni and the basement alumni. Go check out his interview.
Thank you.
He's a bad boy.
I'm okay.
One of Detroit's finest sons.
I took some lessons from Kevin Chow.
See? Also, we have with us, tell us your name.
This is Guy Warren.
Another in the basement alumni. Go check out his interview. It was hilarious. Y'all have to check it out.
And I have changed my ways. I've changed.
Straight and narrow.
Yes. If you know, I have a life is funny that way. But I've changed, and I'm very. You can trust me.
Whenever anybody says you can trust me,
it's not a red flag.
It's a red flag.
You didn't trust me.
There was a trust issue once before, and I'm seeing some. I'm spotting some very nice looking.
Bases.
Still can't trust him, folks. Go check out his interview. Hilarious. Guy Warren, also hanging out with us. Another in the basement alumni. Tell us your name.
Todd Flanders.
Todd Flanders.
Yes,
wow. Also hanging with us. He doesn't know it, but he's an alumni too. He's been in the basement.
Yes, sir.
Tell us your name, sir.
My name is
Emery Canty. That last name sounds familiar.
With the green machine.
You know Reginald Canty?
Yes, I do.
Who is Reginald Canty?
It's my grandfather.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so this is this part of your basement too, because this we saw all this thing Reggie for letting us use the basement. And it looks like you got a bass in your hand. You play bass too?
Get on now. Look at that.
Oh man, we're gonna have to do an interview with you one day. Is that okay?
Get ready.
Okay, cool. And also, we have in the house with us none other than our gracious host.
Yep.
Tell us your name, sir.
Reginald Canty.
That's Grandpa right there.
Grandpa to Emery Canty.
All right. Well, I'd like to thank all you guys for hanging out with us in the basement. So we can interview this fine bass player. For those of you who don't know, Kevin Chown.
That's with an N, Chown. Just think Chown with an H.
Yeah, that's what I said, Chown.
Got it.
So we're gonna ask him a few questions so we can get to know him. And the first question I always like to ask is, if Jimmy cracked corn and nobody cared, why did he keep cracking it?
Nobody
cares. Because he's probably a musician. And you don't have any choice. You got to keep playing. And you don't care, you got to keep stopping. You can't stop.
I'm just playing. No, my first question I like to ask is, when did you start playing the bass and why?
Wow. Okay. Well, I'm 45. And I started playing when I was 15, so this is my 30th year as a bass player, which is ridiculous, because I certainly don't act like I'm my age, but...
No bass player does. No.
Exactly. I started playing bass because I grew up in a musical family in Escanaba, up north, and my dad was a conductor and played pretty much every instrument that there is, as did my mom, who's a piano teacher and composer, so for me it was always around the house, from literally my first memories. One of my first musical memories is being in the pit orchestra with my mom, where she was the musical director of like the Fantastics or something.
Wow.
So I mean, it was always just something that was always around, but then I rebelled and I didn't want to have anything to do with it. But then I heard a guy play drum set, and so I wanted to get a drum set. So my dad brought home a drum set from the high school, and I played drums for a long time. But when I wanted to start playing in bands, there were no bass players, man. You know, it's the classic story, you know. It's the bass player, like, mentality of, okay, we want to play in a bit, I'll play bass. So I got confirmed from the Lutheran church, and I took my church confirmation money, and I bought I can't even remember the bass, it was a piece of crap, and a custom Silver Sparkle amp for church confirmation money for. And I played my first gig a month later. And I started making a living at 15 playing music. I've been doing it ever since.
That is awesome, man. Now, when you say up north, for those who don't know, he is a Detroit bass player, the rest of us.
Yes.
just not from Detroit, not.
I lived in Detroit for a long time because after I got out of high school, I moved right to the heart of the city and I went to Wayne State, which is a great music program.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I had a, you know, it was killer.
So,
I was immediately exposed to
the... So you from the Upper Peninsula?
If you go across the Mackinac Bridge and make a left... and go 2 hours. That's basically where I'm from.
Wow, that's amazing how that's Michigan, but it should be Wisconsin.
Well, I am a Packers fan.
it's just amazing how Michigan, how it works like that.
Yeah.
But that's awesome, man. First of all, again, I'd like to thank you for coming this way, fresh off a tour. Yeah. To come hang out with us in the basement. Absolutely. Man. And I mean, fresh off a South American tour. Yeah. And we're going to get into who you're playing with in a second. Mm-hmm. But what's that in your hand, man? What's you playing there?
This is an Ernie Ball Music Man 5. And this is the first non-custom bass that I ever really owned. I used to be a Ken Smith guy.
Yeah.
Okay. I had a Ken Smith, Chuck Rainey, I still have it, a Chuck Rainey 6. And Lacewood 4, which those are the first nice basses I ever owned. When I was in college, you know, I was into John Petitucci and Stanley Clarke and stuff like that. And those were kind of the basses that I really wanted to play. But when I moved to LA, you know, I started doing more rock stuff because at the end of the day, that's really my roots, is being a rock bass player. And this is the first one that I bought. And I called Guitar Center because I couldn't find a red one with a maple neck. And they didn't have one in stock. I wanted to order one. So the guy really quietly says in the phone, he says, I have one if you want to buy it. Just meet me in the parking lot. So I got a good deal, and I was like $700. Wow. And so I started playing the Ernie Balls, but then I loved it so much it kind of became my thing, and then I reached out to the company after I started playing it a lot, just at first for help with parts because I was breaking it nonstop, but because it's a little, doing my gig can be a little, you know, sometimes
see
I don't,
you around the stage.
I don't necessarily have to throw my bass to the tech on the side of the stage from the middle, but sometimes, you know, I just choose to.
Just because you can.
Just, you know, it's fun. It's for all for the audience. It's all for the audience.
It's a part of the show.
It's all part of the show, right? It's all part of the circus. But, and, you know, I just started slowly working with them. It was just with parts, and then I got another bass when I started doing the bigger tours, and then they've started supporting me tremendously with strings, especially. And I feel the Music Mans are the most versatile bass that there is. It's kind of halfway between a custom bass and a Fender, really. Mm-hmm. And it's the first bass that Leo Fender designed after he left Fender. And I also have an original Your Music Man, pre-Ernie Ball, a 76, which is just, that's really kind of my main bass when I'm in L.A.
This and
is
you live in L.A. now?
I live in L.A., but I'm back in Michigan about 4 months a year.
Okay, so now you, folks, you bass players watching this and trying to take up some tips, you said that you reached out to Music Man, and they now that you got an endorsement with them?
Well, yeah, I mean, endorsements are, you know, you go to the NAMM show and it's hilarious sometimes because, I mean, you see everybody, you know, wanting to get an endorsement with a company and you know, an endorsement is there's an endorsee and an endorser. I mean,
right.
And my role as an endorsee is to support the product and believe in it and play it because I believe in it. And at the end of the day, only approach the companies with that make the gear that you love.
Right.
You know, those are the people that you should want to work with. And then your return for the investment that they make in you with equipment is to use it as much as you can and play it in public and talk about it, just like I'm talking about it now. I mean, I believe in this product and I love it because I've always played it. It's kind of my staple. And that's how you get an endorsement. Real. Be real, man. Don't try to get free gear for the sake of free gear. Just get the shit that you believe in, man.
Right. Yeah, we've had that discussion before. Yeah. I'm a fair weather friend. If I get endorsement one guy and then they leave me and somebody else, I swear up and down, like I said about the other product, this is the best thing you ever.
Hey, trust me, I ain't no saint. All right. I am certainly not perfect, but, you know, now that I've been doing this as long as I've been doing it, I mean, I work with Ernie Ball, I work with Mark Bass, I work with Line 6 for my wireless.
Yeah.
This is all stuff.
Let's talk about these little gadgets down there. What you got going on?
Basically, like me and you have cloned each other.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, it's a really simple rig. I have two different wireless. I'm not using wireless right now, but this is a Line 6 G50. And I also have the new one, the G70.
How do you like that?
And it's great. Still sorting out a couple of little...
What does it do?
What 70? Is
it?
What is the product designed to do? Why do you have
G50 is a great wireless.
It's wireless?
It's 2.4 megahertz, and it gives you all the different, you know, selections as far as channels, and I've got, you know, three different packs for all the different basses I play. It also has something that allows you to dial in cable tone, which I like because, you know, the length of your cable does really make a difference with the tone that you've got. So, I mean, a lot of the gigs I do now, I'm running in-ears. Mm. So, I like to kind of saturate the sound so that it feels like a real sound sometimes because there's nothing worse than just like playing in your head, you know?
That's not good.
But the way that I run my signal is if I'm coming in with a cable right now, but let's just say that I was coming through the wireless, I'd come into the tuner, obviously, got to have a mute. But if I was using the new G70, it's actually a tuner and a wireless in one, so that would be condensed into one pedal. But I like having the pedal here just because it's also my mute and, you know, it just gives me control over not sending a signal to the house. But what I've learned through the years, you know, everybody's always sent, you know, a direct signal. This is a Countryman. I personally think the Countryman is by far the best DI. A lot of people like, you know, the JDIs, but, you know, this is an old standby. This is not a really solid, heavy, well-built box that just always works. It's phantom power, and it also has a phase switch button on it. So if you get phase issues with front of house, you can flip it And for those of you who don't know what phases is sound travels in waveforms, and if they're just slightly off, what happens is that there's phase cancellation. So this box gives you the ability to flip the signal of this so that it basically would match up with what the mic would be, because the signal of the mic moves at a slower pace since it's a microphone than this, since it's the direct. And it's not always a problem, but it can be, and it's nice to have that as an option. This needs phantom power, which means 24 volt power to get a signal at the front of the house. But what I do is I come out of the pedal, and before I go through any of my effects, which is just a simple distortion pedal, and I use a digital delay pedal actually too, I go dry into this to front of house. I think that front of house pretty much always needs just the bass without anything else on it. It needs, you gotta give the front of house guy a break because he's trying to mix a show, you know? And you can't be messing with what he's doing all the time with your pedals. You gotta be consistent, you know? Bass is different than the other instruments because it's so much the root of the mix, and if you're changing the root of his mix all the time, you're screwed. Yeah. Or he's screwed, and then he's gonna hate you, and then you're gonna have a miserable tour, and punches are going to be thrown, and it's not cool. Yeah. So you want to help the guy out, man.
Yeah.
Just give him a clean, direct sound, and then I come out here into my pedals, and then I go into my amp with the distortion, with the delay. So the two signals I have are different from my amp. But no matter what I do, sometimes they're the same. Like, if I've got my pedals off, it's just my amp tone and my direct tone, which are, you know, similar. But when I add effects or when I add distortion, it's just from the amp. So that way I know when I add these tones here, I can actually almost overcompensate because I know that he's already got this here as kind of as the
smart,
as the, you know, the rock of Gibraltar. And I also use a delay pedal. You know, not many people use delay pedals for bass, but I find especially for slow music, like if I'm playing something like like if I'm even playing like a rock ballad, like, just that echo gives it so much more. That's dry, okay? It just gives it that, like, it gives it some like, trail between the notes, you know, to kind of fill that space in, so you've got that nice dry signal down the middle. But I find the delay really works well with that, especially, you know, with distortion, because you get that, you can hear all that, just that I don't use much, just enough to give it a little bit of space. That's why on the pedal I literally have it written as space, and on the distortion pedal it says juice, because it's like those are the things that I want, right?
Nice. Yeah,
so,
I love that.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So well, let's talk about some of the gigs that you currently use these pedals and effects for. Who are you currently playing bass with?
As far as touring goes, well, my own bands. I have a band with Chad Smith from the Chili Peppers, wow, who's a fellow Detroit band,
right? Yeah.
Called the Bombastic Meatbats, and we've been doing stuff for years now. And that's just more of like a, you know, standard, you know, kind of funk rock band. It's like dry, you know. But when I solo and stuff, I like to have, you know, kind of some options. So I use this on this, but I pretty much for that gig pretty much just play dry. I just plug directly into the amp a lot of the time. It's that band for me is more like just like me and three of my friends getting together to play poker. I mean, it's literally like what we do to have fun. So we try not to have any expectations, and every gig is what it is, and we never ever practice, and it's fun.
Wow. What's the name of them again?
The Bombastic Meat Bats.
And we can catch you on YouTube, and we can also buy your CDs.
Yes, you can.
That's right.
Three CDs.
Yeah, each one of them has the word meat in it, I bet.
Yeah, Meat the Meat Bats, 2009, that was the first one. The second one was More Meat. And the third one is a live record from the baked potato called Live Meat.
That's awesome. Yeah. What other gigs you got, man?
I play with a very, very successful European artist named Tarja Turunen, who's a rock singer from a band called Nightwish from back in the day. That's how people would know her originally, but she's had a solo career for, I think, over 10 years now. And she's actually an operatic, classically trained singer, so playing with her is a trip because I don't want to say I took the gig over. You never really take a gig when you're a sideman over it.
Yeah. Right.
I started playing the gig. originally with Doug Wimbish, who's another great bass player.
Of Living Color, for those who don't know.
I mean, he also played on
Grandmaster Flash.
Grandmaster Flash, Doug
playing with Carly Simon.
And he's a solo bassist as well. He's
Rolling Stones.
And he also has the biggest pedal board I've ever
seen. Yes, he does. In my life.
And Doug would laugh if he saw it. But yeah, compared to Doug, man, this is like, you know. It's hilarious when I think about it. But Pearl Music's interesting because Doug started in the band, so even though it has this kind of Euro classical edge to it, Doug's, you know, he's an R&B guy, man. So it had a little bit of that into it, and it's kind of the same way I play, too. So it was a good match. And
she's, like, huge, man, isn't she?
She's very big in Europe and South America. That's where I spend a lot of my tour time with her, and she's got a lot of fans in the States, too, you know? It's just that it's hard to tour in the States. That's the only reason we're not spending a lot of time here. This is the hardest country in the world to tour with foreign musicians. And it's a really unusual band because, you know, I'm from the States. The former drummer was from the States, but he's, you know, he lives in Italy, but he's not even in the band anymore. But the new guy's from Germany, and the guitar player's from Germany, and the keyboard player's from Germany, but he lives in France and Singapore, and the road manager is Swiss, and the monitor engineer is French, and the sound engineer is Finnish, and the light guy's Finnish. It's just like, you know, trying to coordinate all of that stuff. Oh, and her husband, who's the manager, is Argentinian, and it's like, and they've got their baby on the road who's born in, was she born in Argentina or Finland? I can't remember. It's nuts. I mean, it's like, it's the only gig I've ever done in my life where, you know, I'm the only American.
Oh, wow.
Right.
It's a trip, man.
And she's huge, folks, so you need to check out, I checked out her music. It sounds like opera with rock, with some funk, and it's all kinds of stuff going on. And I guess it's an awesome show because she fills up the place, man.
Yeah, I mean, her stuff is like, it can be everything from like really heavy stuff from like, let me see. To like some
right,
like
progressive rock. I heard some of that,
but it always has like a drive to it too. Like, you know, real eighth note driven, you know, it's just power music, and it's cool music. But it's been a really interesting exploration for me with pedals because there's also a cello player in the band, and you know, a lot of the parts that I'm playing are based on like, you know, big ballads. Let me see, what's a good example? So if I've got something like, if you think of it just like a, what key is that in? A typical bass player, what key is that in? If I play something like, past, I would have thought that sounds like a distorted sound, but now if I think of this as a cellist with a bow playing arco, I use distortion to create an arco effect, like a bow,
right?
You know, and you can do it if you finger it right. You know, it just gives you the sustain of a bow. As long as you don't play it too much and you use the effects the right way. So that gig's been really fun for me as a bass player, just tone-wise, because it's forced me to kind of like be a bass player that plays rhythm section bass like I've always played, like Motown kind of bass. Mm-hmm. But it's almost orchestral bass too, like, you know, playing full contra bass too. So that's a really challenging gig, man. And it's big production and big shows, and I have to sing on top of that too. I sing all the background vocals.
Oh, awesome. Man.
That's a fun gig. So there's that.
And then speaking of orchestra, you play with Bach, right?
Sebastian Bach. Yeah. You know, that's a whole, exactly, yeah. That's a whole, you know, everything he does is pretty much down tuned to D, you know, it's just like, you know, real heavy, just like, let me see, I can't think of, I'll play the one song that is actually E tuning. It's just like, Oh, here we go. Dun, dun. like a real big feel right, like that. But you know, when I play, no matter what gig I'm playing, I still play with a real like Jamerson-y Motown punchy feel. To me, like bass playing is all about like the rhythm of the people have to feel it. And sometimes I hear bass players and they play so many notes,
man. Well, that's because they're not from Detroit, man. You have to drink the water to at least once. To,
that's what it's all about, man.
You know, hey, folks, come and drink the water once and you had that feel.
One of my dear friends who I play the Tadia gig with is the guitar player, Alex Schulp. He's from Germany. And when I had brain surgery a couple years back, I was on from the gig for, I guess, about a year and a half. And then I came back to the gig. And we did one gig, and he came up to me after the show, and he gave me a big hug and just said, "It's great that you're back," he said. But this was the line that I'll never forget, and it's kind of become my motto. And he said, "I like playing with you because you provide a carpet of confidence on stage."
Wow, that's pretty good.
And I thought to myself, that's exactly what bass playing is.
Yeah.
You provide a carpet of confidence for everybody else to grow on, you know?
Yeah, you can't be a timid bass player.
No.
It's not a nature of the its role is to be a timid bass player. You
gotta take control.
And for those who are timid, just keep practicing and keep practicing and keep practicing until you become that,
that it's carpet. It's not to say that, you know, it's an impossible task. I mean, there's been years that I've been a timid bass player, like everybody else, man. But it really changed for me when I started playing bigger venues because, you know, the acoustics in a huge room, I'm sure you guys have all played bigger rooms, you know. When you play smaller clubs, when you're younger and you're up and coming, you can get away with playing a little busier because there isn't the acoustic factor that's going to come in and kill you all the time. But if I'm going to play, you know, 32nd note slap bass fills in a ice hall in Eastern Europe, it ain't gonna fly, man.
Nope.
It just doesn't work.
Be doing like that.
Yeah, it sounds like hell, man. And especially with a lot of drummers that play busy too, and guitar players that play busy, and then you add the echo chamber factor, you gotta be, you know, meat. You gotta like give the room. And when you make that transformation into seeing like the waveforms that you're creating kind of like pummel people, that's a trip.
Yep.
That's bass playing to me, you know, pummeling people with like waveforms of sound.
Yeah.
But not, you gotta leave space too, even on the subtle stuff. You know, it's the space, man. Leave the distance between the notes. That's the biggest. That's if I ever say things to bass players when they ask me about stuff, I always say, play less.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know?
Explore the space.
Yeah, right, man. I mean, right. If you listen to, you know, what I like to do is at a slow tempo, I'll take a, what's a good song? Here's one, you guys are. Okay, try that, but try to do it as slow as you possibly can. And do this for like an hour.
Right.
You know, just program yourself to not give in. Don't take the temptation. Just stay there if you can, you know what I mean? It's almost like making love. You gotta just stay in it, man.
But what about you on crack? It's like,
you gotta let it. You see what the magic is? When you stick with it, then it builds tension. It builds tension. So when you do finally play something, there's a release to it, you know?
Right, and that's again, folks. Yeah. If you're really listening, that's the difference between professionals and the rest of us. You know, you should have the ability to sit there and drill yourself for an hour and master whatever it is. I don't care how simple it is, master it, you know? That's the difference between getting the jobs that this guy gets and getting the jobs that I get at McDonald's and Burger King. Okay?
Come on, man.
Now, let me ask you this. How did you get into getting the gigs and then getting the tours and stuff. What happened? What was it? Was it something that you did, or is it something that you fell into to get these tours and professional gigs and all that kind of stuff?
Well, probably number one more than anything is you got to meet people.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, man, of all of the gigs that I'm doing right now, including, you know, Paul Gilbert. Mm-hmm. I just did the new Paul Gilbert record, mm-hmm. which is ridiculous.
It's got to be a monster.
With Thomas Lang on drums and, you know, there's some other artists I work with too and, you know, different records I played on. I've never auditioned a single time in my life.
Ever.
And I shouldn't say that, in my life, in my, you know, as far as like the big gigs that have mattered. Because I think after a while, you get the gigs when you know people. And when you know people and become friends with them and you start working with other musicians who are doing the same thing as you,
they start getting gigs.
Yeah, they start getting gigs just like you do, you know, because this is like a war of persistence, man. I mean, trench warfare is the music business. You got to stick at this. So when you're friends with people and they like you and they believe in you and they bring you on for a gig, they're putting their own reputation on the line to do so.
Yeah.
And if you can earn people's trust enough to where they can put their own reputation on the line to hire you onto a gig that has an opening. It just happened with my buddy Pete. He's playing with Dr. John, you know?
Well, and that's a good gig.
It's a great gig.
Yeah.
Yes.
He, you know, his buddy Jamie. His buddy Jamie's a guitar player. They had an opening. What happens? Pete's got the reputation. He used to play with Zappa, plays Zappa.
Oh, cool.
You know? Wow. There you go. Boom, there's your gig. No auditions required. It's social, though, and it's based on playing together constantly and never stopping, and don't limit yourself to just one band. You know, get out and branch out and do things with different people. Like the Tarja gig. I mean, I used to play with a guy named Tony McAlpine, who's an instrumental guitar player back in the day. That was the first gig I ever had when I moved to Los Angeles.
Huh.
And that gig happened because I used to have this band that you know, Edwin Dare, in Toledo, and we had a manager in California. So I contacted him when I got to California, and I said, Bill Detko, I need a gig. Who do you think's looking for a bass player? Call Tony McAlpine, the drummer. Mike Tirana's handling it. So I called Mike Tirana, went over there. You heard a CD that I'd released.
Yeah.
I got the gig. I had to learn 20 songs in 3 days. And it's, you know, and then you're off to the races, which led to this and led to this. And then Mike moved to Europe years later after, I mean, I'd done everything with him from producing his solo record and everything. I hadn't talked to him in 10 years. And then all of a sudden I get a call. I'm playing in LA at the House of Blues. Come on to the show. It was this artist I'd never heard of named Tarja Turunen. So I went and saw the show. Wimbush was on the gig. I met her. 4 months later, what happens? Wimbush can't do the gig. He's got a Living Color tour. Who do they call?
Yeah.
Me. All right?
Nice.
Sebastian Bach. I'm up in Escanaba rehearsing last summer for the Tarja tour. My buddy Bobby Jarzombek's a great drummer. I look in the newspaper, the Escanaba Daily Press, for who's playing at the Escanaba State Fair. Sebastian Bach. Ah, Bobby Jarzombek's the drummer. I text Bobby. Are you in Escanaba? Yeah. He had no idea I was from Escanaba. I went and hung out, you know, had a great time with Sebastian, made friends. What happens? 3 months later, they need a bass player. Who do they call?
Yeah.
That's just the way it works, man.
Exactly.
Out there.
Yeah.
You know, and when you're real and when you're doing this and you develop a legitimate resume of stuff that you've done and have stuff on YouTube, I hate to say it.
Mm-hmm. Well,
have a social media presence.
YouTube, yeah. Right.
It's all part of the package, man.
Yeah, and that reminds me. I actually saw a song. Do you do solo work as well, right?
Yeah, I released an EP four songs about 2 years ago, and I did an instrumental fusion record back in the '90s when I was still playing Kentzmann bass.
No, I was gonna say you were
back in my nerdy days.
Right.
But I mean, I still kind of use that stuff as a reference too, and that. It's like I've got two different solo releases in two different worlds that I've lived in. You know, one was a little bit more like that virtuosic guitar player world, which meant I ended up kind of getting calls a lot of the time from like guys like Tony McAlpine and working a lot with Shrapnel Records, which is a big
shredder
label. And I was never really into that music, even though I could play it too much, you know. I always wanted to just play, like, I'm into, like, Donny Hathaway live. If I had a favorite record that I had to go to the moon with, that would be probably the one. That's the record that I could play over and over and over and over again and never get sick of. Yet I'm on all these metal and fusion things. Like, what happened? I don't understand. You know?
Okay, so you are a Willie Weeks fan?
Absolutely.
Well, tell me some of the bass players that might have influenced you or that you listen to, or just group them all together. Influences, favorite bassists, and who you listen to as bassists.
When I was, the first probably bass line I think that when I learned it note for note, was that really changed my playing, was I learned the Lemon Song by Zeppelin.
This goes, nice.
The breakdown said that. So what's up?
Wow.
You know, like that, but then, you know, that was my rock kind of thing when I was still living up north, and then I came down to Detroit, you know, and then what happens, I start getting into, you know, so Jamerson to me is like, I reversed to Jamerson. I got into John Paul Jones first, mm-hmm. and then I went back mm-hmm. to Jamerson, which, you know, John Paul Jones loved Jamerson, so
absolutely.
It was kind of the whole thing wow. in reverse for me. So yeah. I would say John Paul Jones and James Jamerson are probably my nice. All-time favorite two bass players. I love Geezer Butler just because yeah. of the use of tone, and, you know, it's just, I love that darkness, you know what I mean? It's just really simple but groovy metal. It's mm-hmm. it's got an attitude, but it's got a groove in a pocket, which I always love Geezer for, and a cool tone and a cool attitude and balance. Never played too much. I loved John Patitucci when I played six string. I mean, I learned all of those songs, Chicory Electric Band and all that stuff, and Marcus Miller. Who doesn't love Marcus, man? I mean, but as far as what's impacted my professional career, I would say definitely just John Paul Jones, James okay. Jamerson, Geezer Butler, for sure. Those three, right down the middle.
Right,
yeah,
that's awesome, man. Yeah. Man, you know, man, I ain't really, really, really want to keep you. Yes, I do, but I
got nowhere to go, brother.
Yeah, but okay. You know, one of the questions I'm going to ask you, and then I'm going to let these other guys, in case they have some awesome questions. Mm-hmm. One thing that I'm curious about mm-hmm. is how the heck can you maintain a living? I mean, how do professional musicians, because you don't have a side job like working at Jiffy Lube or anything like that. You always playing. How do musicians, professional musicians, and I know there are many different circumstances and different cases, but what's the general way that you actually generate your revenue? Do they pay you before the gig, or do they give you a salary? At the end of the year, you get a big check, or you know, how does that work for professional musicians?
The days of salaries, my friend, are long gone. No, that doesn't work that way anymore. I mean, there was a time when you could make 10 grand a week year-round working for Whitney Houston. I mean, those days are over, though. It just doesn't happen. So, you know, most tours now in the States are by the week. And what's even more strange is most of the European artists I work with pay by the gig.
Right.
Which is strange, but I like to work in Europe a lot. It's a great question, because you have to become an expert on such, you know, integral things like currency conversion
yep.
rates.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, I like to work in Europe because for years, they would, you know, pay whatever it was, and for every euro I got paid, it was $1.37 or $1.40. Mm-hmm. So it was, for me,
adds up.
It was worth the extra time to go over to do that, because it was like doing a half a gig for every gig I did. And, but in the States, you know, then you've got guaranteed weekly blocks of time, so you know how many gigs you do. It's not about how many gigs you're doing, it's more about just the week. But then again, you might be working for artists that are doing six gigs a week and just kicking your ass, man.
Right.
So there's a balance between the two. It's like sometimes you feel like you're getting used on the weeks, but sometimes you feel like you're getting underused on the per gigs. It's just like, you know, you can't win, man. But at the end of the day, to make a living in anything in life, I don't care if it's music, I don't care if it's whatever, you got to just be, you have to be wise. And the way that I was fortunate enough to just be wise is by doing some real estate investments very early on, and I've always been very wise about investing my money and not
not being squandering it.
Yeah, you know, and I, but at the same time, you know, like early on when I first started my music career, I was lucky enough to be able to buy a house, but you know, not enough, not able to pay for it as a musician, right? You know, it's like the ultimate irony. So I used to just rent out rooms to my friends, and that continued for years, and then I ended up building a new house, and I built a guest house, and now I have a guest house that generates revenue. You know, you've got to think, you've got to, and if you want to be a musician that really makes money, you've got to write music. That's, I mean, a lot of the money that I've made in the music business has been from writing movie trailers.
I was going to say, you used to do a lot of jingles, didn't you?
Yeah, no, not jingles, really, that's not the Los Angeles world, it's definitely more movie business, TV world based, and you know, movie trailers pay really well because you get paid a flat rate for theatrical performances.
Okay.
Understand what BMI is. Understand what ASCAP is. Understand, you know, everything. Even guys like Thomas Lang, who's probably, I think, one of the best drummers in the world. I mean, he takes gigs with everybody, even if it doesn't pay that much, because he set up a whole music school, which when he's on tour, basically, he sets up a music school wherever he's on the road. So his transportation to get there is paid for. It's cross-promoted with his gig, and he makes all his money teaching when he's on the road playing with other people. Wow. So, you know, you got to balance things out and think smartly. There's different ways to do this. And the biggest mistake you'll make is thinking that the days of the past are still going on, because they're not. And that's not to discourage anybody. It's, I think, to encourage people.
It's a different way to do it now.
Yeah, it's you really have to be creative and figure out ways to lower cost. You know, you just have to be, you have to be wise, man. It's, you're never going to get rich being a musician. I hate to break the news to everybody. This will never, unless you're, you know,
Will Lee.
It's like struck by lightning. It's not to say that people, I've done okay for myself. I'm certainly not rich. I make a good living doing this, and I've made some good investments. And I know guys that have made a lot more money than I have that don't have anything to show for it.
Right.
You know? It's all in the wisdom of how you structure your life. And if you really want to do this, you got to be willing to admit to yourself that you're going to have to live an alternate lifestyle in every freaking way, man. There's no other way. There just is not any other way.
Can you talk about life on the road? Because with what you do, you're spending more time not playing with musicians than you do playing with them, right? Because you're traveling, you're hanging out in hotels and eating and all that. Any insight there?
You mean as to
the avoiding fist fights and all that kind of stuff.
In other words, the 95% of the time of,
right.
of what, yeah.
Right.
I always tell people, I always say, I play music for free, you pay me to get from point A to point B.
Yeah, no kidding.
I say the same thing.
Yeah, it's, you know, traveling is, it's always tough.
Yeah.
I mean, on a since you asked specifically about a personal level, it can be an adventure, man. I mean, not everybody gets along.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody has I'm cut from a slightly different cloth in that I'm kind of like my parents in that it's never good enough for me, mm-hmm. if you know what I mean. So I videotape every show. I watch every show on the bus because I want to make myself better. I'm obsessed with just constantly, you know, when you don't have time to practice, the only time you can improve is by recording yourself and watching and learning. Mm-hmm. And then just saying to yourself, don't make that mistake again. Mm-hmm. That's very simple. And so that's cool for me, but when you're on the road with other people, that might not be, you know, something that they're cool with, so you get kind of frustrated sometimes because you feel that they don't care as much as you, or
that's so true,
or whatever it is, you know, and that's always the personal dilemmas that I've had in the past. But you know, there are magical times too where you find groups of people that do care equally, But then the ironic thing is, you might be working for an artist that doesn't. You know, it's just like, you know, you can't win sometimes. But you know, so you just got to roll with it, and you got to just have fun. You know, and if you're not having fun, then you shouldn't be on the gig.
Right.
You know, that's at the end of the day. If you're having fun, and it's paying a decent amount of money, and you're making good music, there you go.
Yeah.
That's what it's all about.
Anybody else have any questions for this fine bassist?
If Geddy Lee had any influence.
Oh, absolutely, man.
Yeah. Because you kind of, in a sense, your demeanor, whatever, kind of reminds me of Geddy Lee.
Yeah, totally.
Geddy, you like got that. You got that laid back kind of like cool dude. I mean, you know what?
Oh, totally. I used to listen to. Absolutely. But I mean, my dad's from Sault Ste. Marie, so I'm practically Canadian. You know, I didn't know Rush songs. I mean, it would be against my genetics.
I'm almost
Canadian.
I'm telling you, man, we mimic each other so much, because that's where I started. That was, I think Rush was the second band. My first big band was Kiss. Then after them, I heard Rush, and that changed my whole way of thinking. Mm-hmm. I was like, what?
Yeah.
Whoa!
No, man, Rush is, they're huge. And it's not, as far as bands, that's different. I mean, I love Judas Priest, man.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw Judas Priest in Dallas a month ago, and it was just as good. This time is when I saw him when I was 16, man. I was like a teenager. It was great. So I love that stuff. I love, you know, Maiden, you know. Wait, keys that in there. You know, that whole, like, whatever it is. I might be in the wrong key.
It don't matter.
You know what I'm saying.
Yep.
Yeah, that all that stuff. I mean, and when the thing about growing up in Escanaba, I have to tell you, that was a huge advantage to me, now that I look back on it, is with the very same reason I started playing. There weren't any bass players, right? So when I started playing bass, I mean, I could play, but I mean, come on, I was 15, I just started playing bass, I'm sure it wasn't that great, but since there weren't any bass players, I, you know, was playing every weekend.
Yeah, you got the gigs.
Right away.
You was the bass key.
Yeah, right.
So when I came down to Detroit, I started college at Wayne State when I was 19. Mm-hmm. I was a good player, but there were some other players that started at Wayne State at the same time that were way better than I was.
Any of them still around?
Chuck Bartels.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
All kinds. John Barron. All kinds. You know, there's some great bass players at that time. Chuck was a little after me, though,
okay,
if I remember. But I played so many gigs by that point that, you know, I got a little bit of information started, and then it was, for me, just like off to the races. Because at the end of the day, if you know how to play a gig, that's like 75% of this, you know.
Right.
How do I put an amp on a stage and sing background vocals and entertain a crowd in a bar?
Yep.
Right. And know the songs and know the material.
That's it. Right. Knowing the song.
Right. You gotta know what you're doing. Right. And when you grow up in a place where you're out playing bar gigs and you're playing four sets of 45 minutes a night every Friday, Saturday from 15 to 19, which I was, it gives you information that can't be taught at a music school or out of a book.
Exactly, yeah.
It's just life experience.
Yeah. All right. Man, you know, it reminds me of... 2 years ago, I reached out to you. I was like, hey, Kevin, thank goodness for social media.
Exactly.
Bass players, youngsters and stuff, get your network on. Use these things that are available. Mm-hmm. You can reach your favorite entertainers now, like on Facebook.
Yeah, because they want to talk with you.
Or Twitter and all of that stuff. Yeah. They used to... they were untouchable, it seemed like. But I reached out to you 2 years ago and said, hey, man, let me get that interview. You said, okay. And I wanted to thank you, even though it's 2 years later.
Here I am.
2 years later. He's actually reached out to me last year and said, hey, man, I'm at the airport. Detroit Metro.
Yeah, I had a layover. I was like, dude, I'll do it.
Yeah, and I'm like, I was like, I ain't built for travel. You know what I'm saying? But I did. I wanted to thank you before I forget for coming to the BASSmint, man. Hot off a tour. I know you ain't just get off the airplane, but you know what I'm saying?
Thank you.
You know, it's your relaxed time. You about to go to Michigan.
Exactly.
I mean, we're in Michigan. And chill for a minute, right?
Absolutely.
Now, speaking of Michigan, now you live in L.A. now because, mm-hmm. you know, that's one of the spots to get stuff done.
Yeah.
What the future hold for you? Are you staying in L.A. forever?
No. The answer is no. I actually already don't spend a lot of time in L.A. I mean, I've kind of, I'm recently single again. Mm-hmm. So when I kind of got my life back together after all the health issues and all that other stuff, I sat down and kind of figured out what I wanted to do with the rest of my life, you know. And my dad's 85, and he's in great health, and he's up in northern Michigan. Still plays his trumpet, marches in parades,
really?
Plays in the Escanaba good. City Band.
Sweet.
Wow, that's
pretty cool.
You know, he's gigging all, he gigs more than me in the summer, for God's sake. And I just love to go up and hang out with him, you know. It's important to me.
Yes.
And so... Yeah. And my dogs love it too. I've got dogs. Oh, yeah. I love my dogs. And I've got a really nice place up in the lake up there. So I kind of structured it to where I want to spend 3 to 4 months a year in the UP or in Michigan in general, in the Midwest. And then just fly in and out of here while my dogs are here with my dad. And then I'm back in LA about 3 or 4 months a year. And I'm on the road kind of somewhere in the middle there. I don't know. But those are the three places. And it kind of, you know, ebbs and flows through the year in different ways. And I'm like my dad, you know. I'm a restless person. I always have to be kind of on the run, doing stuff. And this is, I've devoted over 30 years of my life to this, you know. And as far as I'm concerned, you know, now I feel like I'm finally getting it.
Okay.
It's taken me that long, and so yeah. I'm still young. And why shouldn't I be out doing whatever I want to do, man?
Exactly.
You know?
Well, you know, the
positivity level coming from you is amazing. I'm stealing some as you, because you're so positive. It's rare to have somebody with that much positivity.
Thank you.
Coming out, coming from them, and because like you were what you were saying about. The truth is that it's hard. It's very hard. But then you pretty much you only touched on that to discourage. You jump right back to the positive aspect about the business of music. So I love that, man. It's like,
I think the world does not have enough courage.
Agreed.
We live in a fearful world.
Right.
It's not necessary. You shouldn't be fearful.
Right. Exactly.
If you want to do something, you should go for it. And when I play concerts now, you know, I try to play with all of my heart, or when I have a conversation like this, because to me, the world needs to see people who are courageous.
Exactly.
We're a courageous, unique bunch of people. And I don't know. I don't want to sound like I'm more important than anybody. I'm not saying that at all. But when you stand on a stage and you give it your all to the point where people can look at it and say, either I don't know if I could ever do that, or maybe I could do that and improve my own life and have a little less fear. Look at this guy.
Yep.
You know?
Yeah.
And
That's saying a lot.
We need to be courageous people, and we need to believe. And when you believe in what you do, and you believe in yourself, and you believe in music because you think it matters, there is no other international language, man. I've been everywhere in the world. There is no language that crosses barriers instantaneously like music. This is the one unique thing that combines everybody together. Okay, so if you've got the ability to do this, okay, you owe it. Maybe I'm being too grandiose here, but
no,
you owe it to kind of the reality of the world to give it away, man.
Yeah, really. I mean,
you do.
What good is it to keep it to yourself?
Totally.
Basically, Yeah.
You know, and you got, and in order to do that, you know, some people, you got to be willing to give up some things that maybe some people wouldn't be willing to give up, man.
Right.
You know, live in a way that maybe some people, you know, are you willing to break down in a tour bus on the 4th of July and not have everybody come and get you? Mm-hmm. Are you willing to, you know, wait for invoices to be paid for insane amounts of time? Are you willing to, you know,
be bumped on your flight?
Yeah. Are you willing to worry about lost luggage? Are you worried of, you know, are you willing to, you know, to just never know what's happening next? I personally embrace it.
Oh, well, yeah.
I love it, man. I have, because at the end of the day, even, it's like I talk to people sometimes and I always tell me what they're planning to do next year. And I think to myself, you know, when is the last time that I was able to, someone say, hey, what are you going to do next year? Where are you going to be next summer? And it's like July of this summer. So if you have no idea what it's like to be a musician, I mean, it could change tomorrow. It could not change at all. I don't know, man.
That is crazy, because that was my next question. What's in the future for Kevin Chown?
Well,
I always ask that question for everybody in the seats. What's in the future?
Well, I'm going to be doing a lot of touring next year. I just don't know the exact dates. I'll be touring with Tarja because her new record's coming out. I just worked on and cut the whole new record, and we have some very special guests on it, which is fantastic.
Some surprises. All right.
And since I did the Paul record, we'll be doing a lot of touring with him, because that's
not here. Not both of them. Will that be here too, or
I imagine Paul will.
Okay,
for sure,
but Tarja probably
not. Yeah, okay. But you never know. I'm trying to set something up right now on the West Coast.
Right? Okay, so how do you manage both bands? Like this cat here, he plays with 50 bands.
He's my student.
Yeah, he actually was a student. How do you not cross dates?
Well, I double manage a couple of my gigs. Like me and Sebastian, on Sebastian, I work the gig with Rob Vanderloos, another bass player. Mm-hmm. He plays with UFO, and I have all my different gigs. So, you know, what we basically said to Sebastian is, you've got a bass player, and it's going to be either me or Rob Vanderloo.
Wow.
And we just sort it out between the two of us, and we let him know who's going to be there.
So, that's awesome, that's cool. Folks. So you can work... Sweet. Work multiple bands. So sometimes you
This is the reality.
You can't do one band anymore.
The reality is you got to fill your calendar, you know? You got to do lots of stuff. And in the world that we live in today, with social media too, you know, I hate to say it, but if you're not up on Facebook putting up what you're doing all the time, you're not playing, people forget about you, man.
They do.
You got to get out there. And even if you do a small gig, you know, try to get some video of it. Take photos of it. You've got to kind of establish this whole presence of yourself. You know, you're not just starting a career in music here. You're like building this like business.
Right.
You're constructing it. It has to be based on skill.
We're laughing because that's something I keep telling somebody.
Yeah, it's going to be based on skill and experience and everything.
Yeah. Okay, man. Well, look. Now, again, I ain't want to keep you. Folks, this has been some very important information for musicians. If you have to, go back and look at it again. It's many parts, because we're probably going to divide this up into two or three pieces.
I'd give it straight.
I love doing it. You know, I love doing the whole thing, but people's attention span. If I can have
this
YouTube...
This holds your attention right here.
If I can have YouTube, let me have control of that counter says it's hour, but let me say 15 minutes just to mess with
it. They won't let you do it?
No. You can't control that length clock. But look, speaking of YouTube, if I want to see some of your stuff, because I just watched a video the other day called with you singing lead, and you had a chick singing lead.
Angel Travis. That was from my EP. That's a song
What's
called.
The name of?
It's called Light the Way.
Light the Way. Mm-hmm. Folks, you gotta go check out Light the Way on YouTube. So if we wanted to find you on YouTube, how do we do that?
Just search Kevin Chown. It's my YouTube page, youtube.com/
usually hit subscribe,
Kevin Chown Official. And just go there. All my videos are there.
Right.
Just Google it. It'll come up there. There's all the different cuts from my jazz solo record from back in the 90s. Called
right.
The record was called Freudian Slip.
It's even one with you playing air drums, air bass, air guitar.
That's the other one, yeah. Dude, I got that video 6 days after I got out of the hospital with brain surgery.
Right. And I don't know if
and
we
that's
could,
why I cut it, because the song's called Alive.
I didn't know if you wanted to discuss that or not, but I was following you when you were you were sick and
Brian, making sure you get in.
So health-wise, everything is good now. You feeling better than ever now.
I am crazier than I have ever been. No, everything's fantastic. I have to say that I am a lucky man.
I am a very
lucky man.
That is awesome. Now, other than YouTube, if I wanted to be your friend and keep up with you like I keep up with my relatives that I don't visit, you got a Facebook page.
Yeah, just go to my last name. My personal page is just Kevin Chown, C-H-O-W-N, but you can also go to my, I think it's Kevin Chown Music, which is my regular music page, which is connected to that too. So either works. I've also got a Twitter page, just Kevin Chown Official.
And do you have a website as well?
I do, kevinchown.com. I got it all.
See that, folks? You get a Facebook,
you better do
a
it.
YouTube, a website, and a Twitter.
Listen to this man. Listen to him. He's wise.
I have three Facebook pages.
That's too many.
No, I do different things. Big Eye Films, Big Eye Music,
oh, okay.
Big Eye Teachers.
There you go.
And my personal page, so I got four pages.
Which is Big Eye Does It All.
And I got a Twitter, I got a website.
Skype.
I got Skype. You got to get all of that stuff,
Instagram.
Man.
Huh? Instagram?
No, that's too much. I don't even know how to use Instagram.
Yeah, a lot of people are getting on that now.
All right, so folks, y'all... I'm gonna edit that part out.
Okay.
Every time I talk about myself,
no,
I always
don't
edit
that. You need that for continuity.
Big Eye. Nah, we're gonna do an interview with me one day. I can talk about myself all day.
You, right. Brother.
Let Kevin interview.
You gotta get over there and set the camera.
Oh,
yeah, we can do that next year.
We'll do it.
Okay, so other than that, I wanted to know, Kevin, is there anything that you would like to say in closing before we let you play us out?
Well, since this is Detroit and we're in the BASSmint, I would just like to say, man, I am honored to be a Detroit bass player, dude. It's the home of the bass. Yeah. I'm telling you.
Yeah.
It really is. And everybody in this town that plays bass, that gets together with this group and has that yearly photo taken, it's a magical, cool thing. And it needs to stay going. It matters, dude. And, you know, it's the Motor City, but, you know, I always looked at bass playing, it's kind of like, I always thought music was good here because of the assembly line. It's like a bunch of people working together with this kind of mechanical consistency and sound to create it. You know, bass playing is kind of the root of all of that mindset and thinking and working together and all that other stuff. You gotta be the carpet of confidence, man. Just do it. But Detroit's got a special thing with bass. I don't know why. It's Jamerson. It's a lot of other people too. And just keep it going, man. You guys are great. I'm honored to be in your presence, and I would like to thank you guys for having me.
We'd like to thank you. Because it's you, man.
You're representing us, man.
Hey, I'm trying my best.
Look.
Trying my best.
We see you and go, that's Kevin, man.
Oh, yeah.
We've
been waiting on this moment.
We were really praying for you, man, when you were going through your brain surgery. But it was, I mean, this is the answer to it because... As serious as it was, even when you still had the staples in your head, you were just like upbeat. You know, pictures were upbeat, and I said, "Look at this cat. He just refuses to lie down." I'm glad you made a recovery, man. I'm glad to see you back here doing your thing after having something.
Thank you.
That you know that medic happened to you. You look like there was nothing. Breathed right through that stuff.
Well,
yeah, he's
you
been
were there, but
he's been through the same thing.
Oh,
you know?
Really?
Yeah.
Man.
It's similar circumstances.
It's you know, it ain't easy. I mean, I had epilepsy that came down when I went to Wayne State. That's where it all started.
That's
when I started having seizures. And it continued for many years, and it ended in getting brain surgery a couple of years back. Mm-hmm. And it was It was a trippy experience, man. But, you know, being in the hospital for that long gives you a lot of perspective, too, man.
Well,
you
see, I don't know it. Yeah.
You see people that have a lot worse than you, man. Mm-hmm. And you see people losing people every day.
Yeah.
Every day when you're in the hospital that long, it's really, really tragic.
Yeah.
And so you come out the other side and you're...
I know.
You're a transformed human being, man.
Yeah.
You realize that every day really does matter, man.
It's a gift.
Every day's a gift. And so... Yeah. You try to give whatever you can back. That's really all it is.
Indeed.
Okay, well, with that said, and all of these photographers photographing.
So photographing
the tent. I hate to say it, other bass players, but I had to photograph them.
Hey, well, man, I want to thank you, man, for hanging out with us here in the basement. That's BASSmint. And this is one of the heavy hitters, folks. We had a heavy hitters come in here. We had the little guy who just started playing come in the basement. And everybody's welcome to come in the basement if you play bass. And not if you play bass. You can play other instruments. But come on in the basement. Let us interview you. And you don't even have to play that good, you know, or you can play excellent like this guy right here. You know what I'm saying? So come on and hang out with us. And with that said, thank you, Kevin. And could you play us something out, brother?
Sure, man. All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, Detroit bass player, Kevin Chown.
Crowd goes wild.
All right, you guys. Had a grab.